بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In this video, I'm going to summarize the first 2 weeks of lectures that we have taken in histology. So let's begin. In the first lecture, the doctor started the lecture by presenting this photo. He just wanted us to know that all the tissues in the human body came from something called germ layers. This germ layers, you are going to take a whole idea about it in the embryology, in the third week of development. Okay, but for now, just know that endoderm, mesoderm, ectoderm are names of those germ layers, which the basic tissues came from them. Then we talked about the cell. First thing, we have the classification of cells. Simple classification, we classify cells into prokaryotes and eukaryotes. Prokaryotes lack nucleus, and the eukaryotes have nucleus. Secondly, we talked about basic structure that we find in all cells. We have three basic structures. Number one, the plasma membrane, two, the cytosol, and three, organelles. In the first lecture and in the second lecture, we talked about those three structures. Let's see them here. Okay, components of the cell. We have cell membrane, we have the cytoplasm. In the cytoplasm, we have the organelles. Some organelles are membrane bound and some organelles are not membrane bound. And we have the nucleus, the nuclear membrane, the nucleoplasm, and the nucleolus. Firstly, we talk about the cytosol. Just two informations about it. It's a colloid-like material, semi-fluid, made of proteins, electrolytes, carbohydrates. The cytoplasm, we have a cytoskeleton. That's it. The plasma membrane, first thing, you need to know the functions of the plasma membrane. What does it do? Number one, it's separation. Number two, signal transduction. And number three, it's a selective permeability. Okay, عازل وينقل الإشارة وselective permeability يعني انتقاء اختياري للمواد اللي بسمح لها بالدخول للخلية والمواد اللي ما بسمح لها بالدخول للخلية. المعلومة الثانية, second information, it can't be seen by light microscope. Okay, then we are going to talk about the structure of the plasma membrane. It consists of lipid bilayer, phospholipid and cholesterol, and the contents in this plasma membrane, we have 35% of lipids and 50 to 60% of proteins. We are going to talk about each component very fastly. This is the phospholipid. It consists of a polar head attached to the glycerol through a phosphate bridge. Okay, and a non-polar tails. One of them is saturated and the another one is unsaturated. They are linked to the glycerol through covalent bonds. Now we are going to talk about the cholesterol in the plasma membrane. It just do a simple function. It stabilize and regulate the fluidity. Okay, cholesterol stabilize and regulate the fluidity. And these are the carbohydrates which attach to the integral protein and peripheral protein. They do simple function, transport, communication, and adhesion to another cells. Okay, lastly, we will talk about proteins, the function of the proteins. Proteins function as transporters, unsure receptors, enzymes, and even other functions. Now we will just talk about the receptors. Okay, cell surface receptors consist of proteins. We have three types of them. In this picture, I just want you to differentiate between two things, between a receptor and a signal. What is a signal? A signal, or sometimes it's called a ligand, it's a molecule. When it attached to a receptor, it makes the receptor to do a function or to make an action. Simply, signal molecule attached to a receptor, so the receptor will do an action, will have a relay, okay, a message that will be amplified, so to do a function in the cell. Okay, now we said that the cell surface receptors are a protein, and we have three types of them. I will just mention the names with small details. Ion channel linked receptors, this is the picture for them. They are activated when the signal molecule attached to the receptor, so the ions can get inside the cell, simply. G protein linked receptor, we will talk about them in physiology. But for now, what you need to know about something called G protein. You need to know that this G protein consists of three subunits, alpha, beta, gamma. Our concern, الاهتمام تبعنا, with the alpha subunit. Alpha subunit have two states, an active state and inactive state. It's activated when it's bind to something called the GTP, and it's inactivated when it's bind to something called GDP. So GDP inactive, GTP activate. When alpha subunit bind to the GTP, it dissociate, تنفصل, dissociate from other subunits and go to an enzyme called adenylate cyclase, attach to it and activate this enzyme to produce or to confirm, to change ATP into cyclic AMP, and the cyclic AMP will go and continue the function. This subject we will take it in huge details in physiology, but for right now just know that three subunits, alpha, GTP, it's activated, go to the adenyl cyclase and make him change ATP into cyclic AMP. The last kind of cell surface receptor is the enzyme linked receptors. Just know the name. Lastly, in this lecture, we talked about the electron microscopic appearance of cell membrane. We said that we have two electron dense layers. This is one of them, and this is the another one, two electron dense layers. In the center, we have a radiolucent layer, and we have an outer opaque layer and an inner radio opaque layer. Okay, how the cell membrane appear in the electron microscope? By two electron dense layer. In the middle, we have radiolucent, and in the sides, we have an outer and an inner radio opaque layer. That's it. In the second lecture, firstly, we talk about transport through the plasma membrane. I will not talk about this subject here because we talked about it in the physiology. Then we talk about cell nucleus. It's the command center. In some cells, you might have one or more, but no nucleus in red blood cells. Don't forget this information. Red blood cells don't have a nucleus. Often, it's spherical. The size of it, 5 to 10 microns diameter. When it's active, it looks pale. And this is called euchromatin. This word from the book. I just put it here. Okay. Inactive, it's look dark. Heterochromatin. Okay. Just know those things. Active, it looks pale. Inactive, it's dark. Okay. It has a double membrane, nuclear envelope, similar to the plasma membrane. The outer envelope is attached, or it's continuous with the endoplasmic reticulum. The nuclear envelope, it's about 70 nanometer lined with pores. We will see them now. And it works like an active transport, variable appearance, contains DNA and many things. Now we will just see a picture for the pores. This is from the slides. I just want you to notice that we have something called rings. We have three rings. Cytoplasmic ring and nuclear ring or nucleoplasmic ring, and here something called middle ring. I think it's this one. Okay, cytoplasmic ring, why they called it cytoplasmic? Because it's near the cytoplasm. The nuclear ring or the nucleoplasmic ring, they called it like this because it's near the nucleoplasmic or the nucleoplasm. Okay, the nucleoplasmic ring, it has some function with sending the RNA out of the nucleus, just for your information. Okay, now we will talk about the cell organelles. We will start with the endoplasmic reticulum. It continuation with outer nuclear membrane. It has a single membrane, bilayer. The lumen, this is the lumen. Okay, we called it cistern. Okay. The rough endoplasmic reticulum, it's attached with ribosomes. So we know that ribosomes is the site of formation of proteins. So the rough endoplasmic reticulum, formation of proteins. The smooth endoplasmic reticulum, it's just formation of lipids. Okay. Now we will talk about Golgi apparatus. It's a parallel stacks. The lumen called cisternia. This is the lumen between cells. الفراغ, cisternia يعني الفراغ, بس اللي هو موجود بين الخلايا. The cyst network of cell of sacs is near to nucleus and it's convex. The trans network is opposite to the nucleus and it's concave. How is this? Let's see it. This is the cyst face, okay, near to the nucleus, and it's convex, and the trans face is concave. Okay, what is the function of it? It processes proteins, lipids, anything that comes from the endoplasmic reticulum, and it uses transport vesicles for movement of anything that produced by Golgi. Okay, now we will talk about the mitochondria. You need to know it has a double membrane. Okay, let's see them. This is the outer membrane. I know the picture is not that clear, but it's obvious. يعني. This is the outer membrane. This is the inner membrane. Between them, we have intermembranous space, and this is the matrix. Okay, produce ATP by respiratory enzymes on inner membrane. You need to know this information very clear. The inner membrane has something called ATPase pump, which pump hydrogen from matrix to intermembrane space. Okay, here is the intermembrane space, and this is the inner membrane. We have the ATPase pump here, which pump the hydrogen from the matrix to the intermembrane space. This movement of hydrogen is the one that's responsible for making the ATP. Okay, and the matrix called Christia. And it's contain its own DNA, but most of the mitochondrial proteins are manufactured in the cytoplasm. Okay, now we will talk about vesicles. We have a few types of vesicles in the cell. Name reflect function. We have transport vesicles, small sacs of membrane which move bulk cargo and membrane around the cell. Okay, like in the Golgi apparatus and the ER. Now we have something called endosomes. Endosomes, بالعربي, جسيم داخلي. Okay, they define it as membrane-bound compartment inside eukaryotic cells. Endosomes represent a major sorting compartment of the endomembrane system in cells. We have three pathways for an endosome. Endosome is something big, okay, something a membrane-bound in the cell. We have three pathways. هناك ثلاثة طرق للإندوزوم عشان يشتغل. First one, it may be endocytosis or pinocytosis. Pinocytosis. Endocytosis is the way that the cell eat, and pinocytosis is the way that the cell take fluids. Second thing is the phagocytosis. Phagocytosis is the way that the cell use to kill invaders like bacteria or viruses. Number three is the autophagy, is the way that the cell use to destroy the unfunctional organelles. Okay, so endosomes, something in the cell, it's a membrane-bound compartment. It has three pathways, either be an endocytosis or pinocytosis or phagocytosis or autophagy. Lysosome formed from the late endosome. When the endosome do something like phagocytosis or autophagy, lysosome go inside the endosome with the acid phosphate and these things to produce its function. What is the function of lysosome? It's active digestion. Okay, we have something called residual bodies. Residual bodies is just the undigested materials of the lysosome. When lysosome digests something and it couldn't digest it, we called it residual bodies. Those residual bodies, we see them mainly in the permanent cells. Okay? And we have a disease related to those residual bodies. We call it Tay-Sachs diseases. It's the lack of lysosomal activity leads to accumulation of undigested materials. It occurs as lack of an enzyme. This is the name of it, hexosaminidase, and I don't know how to spell it right, that digest gangliosides. Okay, lack of this enzyme will have Tay-Sachs disease. It affects your children and disable the neuronal transmission. The doctor, okay, When he mentions a disease, just save it as your name. Now we will talk about peroxisomes. It's a membrane-bound structure, function a few things, use oxygen to oxidize certain substances, substrates, and remove hydrogen atoms from hydrogen peroxide. Okay, oxidize and remove hydrogen from hydrogen peroxide by catalase enzyme. Catalase damage and detoxifies the drugs and destroy toxins and beta oxidation of fatty acids. So peroxisomes, what the function that they do? Oxidize, remove hydrogen from hydrogen peroxide by catalase, and detoxify drugs, detoxification of drugs and destroy toxins, and beta oxidation of fatty acids. Now the proteasomes, just know that they are something that can digest or destroy anything have ubiquitous. Okay, parallel shaped structures that assemble and digest specific proteins that are marked for destruction by ubiquitins. When ubiquitins attach to something, proteasomes are activated. That's it. Now the last organelle, centroids. They are two cylinder at 90 degree. Okay, let's see them. Two cylinder at 90 degree between them. Okay. They are consist of 9 macrotubules, triplets, plus proteins. Try to see a picture so you can have this structure in the right way, but just to know, 9 macrotubules, triplets, and proteins. The functions that they do, they contract and organize macrotubules network, especially in mitosis and cilia. That's the main information about them. Now we will move to the third lecture, which was about cell division. First thing, we will talk about type of cells according to the cell division. So how cells, if they divide, if they not divide, we have three types. Type number one, the actively dividing cells. They are the cells that have the power to divide. Example for them are the blood cells, the bone cells, the epithelial tissue. Secondly, we have the facultative dividers. They are cells have the ability to divide, but they need a stimulus, like the liver cells. Number three is the non-dividing cells. They are cells that are maturated and differentiated and can't be divided, like cardiac and nervous tissue cells. Then the doctor talked about the stem cells. We have something called multipotent vis particular. Just note that the stem cells, we can take them in different stages. Okay, from the embryonic germ layers, for example. Depending on the stage which you took the stem cells, you might have stem cells that multipotent. Multipotent mean they can form different types of tissues, or particular which form only one type of tissue. Okay, stem cells depend on the stage that you have took the cells from. Some stages give a multipotent stem cells which can rise different type of tissues. Other stem cells give particular stem cells which give only one type of tissue. Now sexual reproduction, the production of germ cells like sperm and oocyte. Now we will talk about the cell cycle. We know that the cell cycle is of two phases. We have something called the interphase and the M phase or mitosis. First we will talk about the interphase, and secondly we will talk about mitosis. Interphase is the major part of the cell cycle, because in this diagram you notice that almost 75% of it is for the interphase. Okay, it consists of G1, S and G2. What is G1? It's the longest phase. What happened inside it? The cell grow and mature and perform a function. After doing this, the S phase comes. It's the phase that duplication of a genetic material, the DNA, happened in it. The G2 phase, after duplication of DNA, and the cell is now ready to duplicate the proteins and other factors to be ready for the duplication. So G1, S, G2. Now we will talk about the M phase or mitosis. It consists of four phases. Number one, the prophase. It's the formation of mitotic spindle, the most or the major actions that happen here, formation of mitotic spindle, the chromatin in the nucleus begins to condense and become visible in light microscope. That's very important. The nucleus membrane dissolves. When the nucleus membrane dissolves, we call this the prometaphase. Prometaphase, just it's a phase between prophase and metaphase. Okay? Exactly, they called it the phase that started at the end of a prophase and the beginning of metaphase. You don't need to know these details, just know that when the nuclear membrane dissolves, it's prometaphase. Okay? And this picture shows us that the prophase, the mitotic spindle, okay, and the chromatin begins to condense and become visible by the light microscope. And the nuclear membrane dissolves. Okay, now, metaphase, spindle fibers align. They sometimes called it the aligning phase. The spindle fibers align the chromosomes along the equator, خط الاستواء. Okay, the anaphase is the separation phase. The paired chromosomes separate at something called kinetochores, I don't know how to spell it. This is a picture for them, kinetochore. Okay, this is the centromere, the microtubule spindle. So in the anaphase, we have the separation of the chromosomes in the kinetochore. Okay, here the picture shows them exactly. Now let's see the telophase. Pairs of identical chromosomes reach either poles of the cell. Okay, new membranes form around the daughter nuclei while the chromosomes disappear and are no longer visible under light microscope. So when we can see the chromosomes in the prophase, when they are disappeared in the telophase, don't forget this information. Cytokinesis or the abortion of the cell may also begin during this stage. What is the difference between telophase and cytokinesis? This picture presents this. Telophase, the chromosomes go to the poles, but a cytokinase is the separation or cleavage of cells. This picture summarizes all the things that I talked about, but I don't think that we need to mention the information again. We'll just move on to meiosis. Before talking about meiosis, we need to know some information about chromosomes. Chromosomes in a diploid cell, diploid means 2n. Okay? Diploid set for humans, 2n equals to 46 chromosomes. We have something called autosome and something called allosome. Autosomes are homologous chromosomes, one from each parent. In the human body, we have 22 pairs are autosomes, and the allosomes, we have only one set of pairs. In Arabic, autosomes, chromosomat jismiyya. Well, allosomes, chromosomat jinsiyya. Okay? The allosome, we have, you remember those information for sure, female is an XX, the male is an XY. And most plant and animal adults are diploid to N, but only eggs and sperm are haploid N. Okay? This information are very simple. Now we will talk about meiosis, the last thing. Meiosis consists of two stages, meiosis 1 and meiosis 2. First, we will go through meiosis 1, and lastly, we will go to meiosis 2. Meiosis 1 is also called reductional division. Why? Because we are going to reduce the number of the chromosomes in the cell. First phase in meiosis 1 is the prophase number 1. In this phase, we have something called bivalent. I will explain this in the picture. Bivalent has 2 chromosomes and 4 chromatids. Okay, bivalent, 2 chromosomes and 4 chromatids. Homologous chromosomes pair and form synapses. This is the major actions in prophase 1. Now we have other simple actions. Chromosomes become visible. Crossing over occurs in this stage. Okay, in prophase 1, crossing over occur. This word, chiasmata, I don't know exactly how they spell it. Okay, but when you see this word, you know that they are talking about crossing over. Okay, the nucleolus disappear, mitotic spindle forms, and the nuclear envelope disappears. Let's see the picture. We are talking about meiosis number 1. We are in the prophase 1. What happened in this phase? we have something called bivalent. What is bivalent? Okay, it's the we have those chromosomes, okay, two chromosomes pair together in something called tetrad. Tetrad بالعربي يعني رباعي. Paired maternal and paternal homologous chromosomes with two chromatids each. Okay, bivalent. Just know that two chromosomes align with each other, bind to each other. Okay, so we have two chromosomes, four chromatids. This is the non-sister chromatids from here and from here, and this is the sister chromatids. This is the chiasma, a site of crossing over. Okay, and this is the centromere. And that's it. Just know that in the prophase 1, we have something called bivalent. It's a tetrad. What is the tetrad? Two chromosomes align with each other, bind to each other. Okay? We have two chromosomes and four chromatids. Now let's move. We are talking now about metaphase 1. The bivalence, each composed of two chromosomes, four chromatids, align at the metaphase plate. We said that metaphase is the aligning phase. Let's see the picture. This is the chromosomes align. You have chromosome, two chromosomes. This is the chromatid 1, chromatid 2, chromatid 3, chromatid 4. So, two chromosomes, four chromatids. This is the aligning of the chromosomes in the metaphase. Now let's see the anaphase 1. The chemistia separate chromosomes, each with two chromatids move to separate poles. Each of the daughter cells is now haploid, 23 chromosomes, but each chromosome has two chromatids. Anaphase 1, always, metaphase is the aligning phase. Anaphase is the phase of pulling the chromosomes towards the poles. Okay, we have in each pole, in each side of the cell, number, same number of chromosomes and same number of chromatids. 23 chromatids, 23 chromosomes, 23 chromatids. Each chromosome has two chromatids, and each chromosome has two chromatids. Okay? In the telophase, we know that it's the phase that the nuclear envelopes or separation of cells may happen here. Chimeric form, or the cell may quickly start meiosis too. So to summarize what we have talking about, we are talking about meiosis. Meiosis consists of two stages. First stage, meiosis 1, consists of four phases. Phase 1 is the anaphase. Sorry, is the prophase. In this phase, we have something called bivalent. It's the chromosomes pairing with each other, binding to each other. In the second phase, which is the monophase, the chromosomes aligning in the equatorial line. In the anaphase, the chromosomes are going to the poles, and in the telophase, the nuclear envelope may reform or the cell just go to meiosis 2. Okay, meiosis 2, they called it equatorial division. It's just similar as mitosis. However, we have no S phase. Why we don't have no S phase? Simply because the amount of the DNA was duplicated before starting meiosis 1. So I don't need to duplicate the amount of DNA another time. Okay? Meiosis 2 separates the chromatids, producing two daughter cells, each with 23 chromosomes haploid, and each chromosome has only one chromatid. This picture summarizes what I have talking about. Interphase 1, before beginning of the meiosis, the amount of the DNA is duplicated. Everything in the cell duplicated, the proteins, everything, okay? Meiosis 1, we end with two cells. Each cell have the same number of chromosomes and same number of chromatids. 23 chromosome, 23 chromosome. Each chromosome has two chromatids. So, meiosis 1, simply, it's just the separation of chromosomes. But meiosis 2 is simply separation of chromatids, okay? To end with four cells with haploid daughter cells. Lastly, we have a small comparison between mitosis and meiosis. In mitosis, homologous chromosomes are independent, but in meiosis, homologous chromosomes pair, forming bivalent. Okay, remember that in mitosis there wasn't any chromosome pairing with another chromosome, but in meiosis, in prophase 1, the chromosomes for the bivalent. Okay, daughter cells are diploid, but here daughter cells are haploid. in identical daughter cells, but the daughter cells are not identical because we have the crossing over. And that's everything about the lecture that we have taken in the first 2 weeks. My best wishes, your colleague Omar Sawas.